uncharted waters, uncharted lands. Oh, 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 the unexpected round every bend. Oh, 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 Jesus is our guide, helping us to survive.
Break every chain. journey, the devil's doing everything he can to keep us from that journey, isn't he? There's a calling that all of us have, but will we respond? Many are called, but few are chosen. And so first thing we're going to do is have the youth come back and do a drama called Everything. It's about all those things that come against us and God's perfect will. Amen? So youth, come on up.
Tell me, how could it be?
Had such fun time working with them all week. Wow. Well, next, okay, I have given a time limit. We have four speakers, 28 minutes, 7 minutes each, including me. I'm the last one. Will I get 7 minutes? We will find out. We will find out. First person, we have this team from Orlando, and we got to have one of them speak, right? And so we're talking about our journey, and then I'm going to close up with talking about your journey. Amen. So the first person we have is...
Hey guys, how's it going? Man, off the map. That's kind of what my life has been, a little bit off the map. Going to Mars next, so that's really off the map, you know? God said go, so hey. All right, well, the last excursion that the Lord had me on was between China, France, Canada, and I wanted to share a story from France. And the Lord really just showed me his intentions with how my path was directed. So I was with my best friend, and we went to a cemetery in Paris, the largest one in France, and we had just bought our metro tickets, and they had been like 44 euros, and we're on a budget, so we got those for 5 days so we could travel, and every day we wake up, just ask Holy Spirit, where do you want us to go? So we go to the cemetery, and we're walking around for like 2 hours. It's massive. And then I see a little metro ticket on the ground, and I think to myself, wow, maybe, oh, that's so sad. Like, maybe I should make sure I have my ticket, because someone lost theirs. So I look in my bag, and what do you know? It wasn't there. So I'm like, ah, what am I going to do? I just paid, and I don't know. I'm like, not, I'm, you know, panic automatically. But Holy Spirit just said, calm down. You're going to find it. So I look, and I see all these little metro tickets on the ground, and I start retracing my steps, and he's telling me, I'm hearing him, look at where these little tickets are taking you. What? That, okay. So I'm looking, and I'm retracing my steps, and I'm finding all these little metro tickets. I'll walk a little bit this way, find another one, go down, up, around, everywhere, see all these graves, and, you know, thinking about raising them from the dead, but, gotcha. You thought that was going this way, right? All right, anyway, so I'm going down and around, and an hour later or so, I find my ticket. There it is, like right at the entrance of where we had come through. There's my little ticket. I'm like, thank you, God. Thank you for leading me, because I didn't know. So I was so thankful, and then eventually my friend meets me back at the entrance. Whew, I'm so excited right now. So we're going out, and it was phenomenal, because originally our plan was that we were going to go around the cemetery and go through the back entrance to go back to the bus. But we went back through the front entrance, and what do you know? Divine appointment from the Lord. We met this boy, his name's Stephen. He was from Arizona. He was on his own little adventure. And he's looking for Notre Dame, didn't speak French, so he's like really happy to find us. And we're like, hey, Stephen, yeah, you could come with us. So we pick him up, and we go, and we see the Notre Dame, and we're having such a great time with him, and just a fun time to bless him. Turns out he was a former like Catholic, but he knew kind of about Jesus, and wasn't fully there, but the Lord used my friend and I to bring him there. So God is so intentional. Amen. We start to speak into his life, because you know your words, they bring life or they bring death. So we speak over his life, and we start to tell him that God's his father and God loves him. And he asks us, what does it mean when you put God first and you hear his voice? What is that? It was an open door. And we just start inviting Holy Spirit, and we just tell him. And you know, when you talk about God, he's there already. So he starts to manifest. And Stephen said he was feeling warm heat in his stomach. And we tell him, that's Holy Spirit. We're introducing you right now to our friend. He's our friend. He's not some weird thing. He loves you. He loves him. God brought my friend and I all the way from here to go to France for Stephen. Brought Stephen in our path, used me losing my metro card just for Stephen. And people think there's such thing as coincidence. There is no coincidence with Holy Spirit. He knows what he's doing. I don't know what I'm doing. In fact, sometimes I just marvel, because he's directing my footsteps even when I don't realize it. So praise God for Stephen. We told him about the love of God and the Father heart, and he starts crying. He takes off his glasses, and he's like, I can't explain this right now. because you can't explain it with this intellect. Something supernatural occurred for Stephen. And I was blown away. I was like, Stephen, you're going to get rocked by God, and you're going to go home, and Holy Spirit's filling you up right now. And he's like, yeah. So it was awesome. But how many of you want to yield more to Holy Spirit? Come on. How many of you want to yield more to Holy Spirit? He's inside of you. You can't miss him. If you're following him, he's going to lead you. You have to trust him. You have to hear his voice. And you have to know how he speaks to you. So Holy Spirit, would you speak to every heart in this room right now, God? Would you increase a hunger in their innermost beings to be able to receive from you and to hear your voice? I say, open up spiritual ears in Jesus' name. Open up spiritual eyes. May every five senses that we have be opened up to you right now, that we smell you and we taste you and we feel you, God, and we know your presence. And we thank you, God, that you do direct our paths, and it's always your map, Father. Hallelujah. Amen.
That's Julie. She's bringing the fire. And God told me when I knew she was speaking before me, well, you're going to bring the oil. And part of my journey has been to find out who I am as a leader, and to find out that I lead with peace and with harmony and in a secondary place. Like, I'm so content to follow a strong leader, to get behind them with my gifts and my skills with people and in leadership. I was in YWAM in South Africa. I came home in May. My journey was really, really tough. It was probably the hardest 6 months of my life. And I've been in some hard cultures and some hard climates. But this was the hand of God that put me in a place that I had to learn who I was, and that I could stand strong in adversity, and that I am a good leader, and that he could bring my gifts to the surface. I was thinking about it when Josh asked me to speak, that this journey really started 7 years ago. God knows I love numbers, so a lot of times he'll talk to me about numbers, and this seven thing I kept thinking about. And you know, in 2008, we went to St. Lucia. It was my first trip overseas. It was my first time out of the country. And in that birthed my journey of loving the nations, of loving the work of God in other cultures, of loving people all over the world. It's been amazing, you know, the places that he's taken me. That same year, I joined the Equipping Center, which was, again, life-changing. You know, it set some people, young people in this church, on their own journeys of still being in ministry today. Over the course of that time, you know, I've been all over the place, been all over the world, and I had some great ideas about where God was leading me. I had some real clear vision for myself, but, you know, he changed that around a little bit. He brought Youth with a Mission into this area, brought John Henry here. John's a trustworthy, strong leader. God's given him vision for this area, for Ocean City. And so I left for South Africa thinking that I was going to stay there. That was my idea. That I would move halfway across the world and I would make my life somewhere else. My family expects that, you know, for me to go away and not come back. And then at the end of my time, I took a few weeks and I said, God, I'm going to put this before you, and I'm going to leave it in your hands, and you can lead me how you want to. And he gave me this verse from Isaiah that said, with tears of joy, I will lead them gently home, and they will walk by quiet streams and on smooth paths where they will not stumble. And I just was like, okay, God, that seems so clear. You know, I never had a settled heart about living in New Jersey. For all this time, it's been like a quest, and it's not about being in a different place or culture for me. It's about knowing who I am, and it's about knowing that I'm where I'm supposed to be in the hand of God. And I know that that's a journey that he wants for all of us. Like, find out who you are. Find out that you don't have to be like everyone else. Do you know? Find out what your strengths are as a leader. He's called all of us to leadership. I did want to share a few photos. Let me just run through them real quick, Matt, because I did end up, you know, through all this adversity and this, you know, this hard time, I end up leading my teams out. I was a student leader because they didn't really have a staff person to take the teams out on outreach, so I ended up leading the student teams out to Madagascar and to Mauritius. So Madagascar is a really tough nation, like, to minister in, just physically, just because it's very muddy, as you can see. It rains every day, almost all day. But I had this team, and that's the other thing I wanted to say. You know, God sets us up. And He sets us up to get us in the place where we need to be at the right time. So He sends this team out with me, who's seven people from seven different cultures. In Madagascar, you don't see diversity in their... And even in people that come to minister, there's a lot of Koreans in Madagascar doing ministry, but not diversity. So I get to lead this team that's from seven different cultures, six nations, seven cultures. And just, we were like a, you know, like a, you talk about signs and wonders. It was like every time we stood up, we were a sign and a wonder to them. So just made ministry so, so easy. The team was like an amazing blessing. Just, they were willing to do absolutely anything we asked them to do. We found out that what God had really called us to was to serve the base that we went to, He said, tend their fires. Because what happens is when you minister in a physically tough area, these young leaders on this base are, do you know, they're plugging away at it. They're walking through mud pretty much every night, and they just have to strap their sandals on and their raincoats and go. And they were burnt out. My team came and ministered to them and to their cell groups, and when we left, not only did we find out that they were encouraged and lifted up, Matt, you can flip to the next slide too. We found out that their cell group leaders were revived and ready to go out again. Yeah, you can keep going, Matt. Yeah, just some of the different places there would be. That's a really rural church that we worked at for a week. Then we went to Mauritius. Again, I just saw how God orders teams, orders your steps when you trust in Him, because the team that I went to Mauritius with was very peace-loving, very reliable, very kind of down to earth. Do you know, and what Mauritius needed, especially from a YWAM team, was humility. And they needed healing to happen among their churches in the area, because they worked very, very hard at reestablishing relationships with the churches, because there's been a lot of brokenness. By the time we left, we probably had ministered in about six different churches, and just that God opened so many doors to do so many different things and to bring connection even with YWAM to the local churches there, who are really going out and doing the work in the area. And then I just, you know, part of this calling home is to have roots down in this area. Yeah, you can go to the last one, Matt. So right now, you know, God spoke to John Henry about a year and a half ago, run a DTS in Ocean City. And he said no at first. And then when he said yes, you know, God has started to open doors. I'm so thankful Joanne's part of our team. She's like one of my most trusted friends and mentors, and I get to work with her. And John too, like I said, is just a trustworthy leader. So we're pioneering again, which God knows I love the work of pioneering, because you get to put your stamp. You get to say, I was a part of this, and who I am is written into this organization. So I get to be a part of establishing YWAM and reestablishing YWAM in New Jersey and establishing YWAM here in Ocean City. We're running our first CTS February of 2016. Please talk to me about that. I'm here all the time. I'm going to be out in the foyer after church, but talk to me about it. Find out how you can help. Find out how you can be involved. We have a very small staff right now. We do need some more staff. We're reaching out into the YWAM, but we've got local pastors coming to teach. We want to do the same thing here. We want to be a peacemakers in this area. We want to have great connections with local churches, you know, and go as wide as we can so that God can move through all of our connections here. But anyway, we're just so excited. Thank you, church, for praying while I was away and praying now. I appreciate you guys so much. I know that you've been behind me. Yeah, thank you.
Just for those who don't know, I mean, we have a lot of YWAMers in here, including me. I was a former YWAMer and my wife, Youth with a Mission, and a DTS is a discipleship training school. It's a 5-month school for those who have graduated from high school and above, and just an excellent school to really hear from God, learn to hear from God, and learn God's plan for your life. So it's exciting to hear that after over 10, 15 years, New Jersey did not have a YWAM base, because they're all over the world. Now New Jersey has one in Ocean City. And amen. Amen. And with that in mind, Amy is now going to become a full-time missionary with Youth with a Mission. And she'll be under Praise Worldwide. We want to support her 100% in every way of encouraging her and encouraging you to get behind her financially and prayerfully. So she's going to be trusting God to provide for her every need. Amen. So I want you all to really pray about how you can support her. Yes, she's here in Ocean City, not in another nation, but God has called this area to be ascending base to the nations. And the nations, we don't have to go far anymore because the nations are coming here. The nations are already here, and it's going to even be more so. It's been prophesied that this would be a place where people would come and get rest, people would come to get restored, and then to be sent all over the world. So I really encourage you to get behind Amy, understand her heart and her vision, and she's going to be doing great things in our community and throughout the world. Amen. Amen. Well, I think 8 minutes. Seven? Oh, yeah. I'm going to keep to everybody else, and I got to have seven. So we might even do this in 27 minutes then, because we started at 11:40. So we're doing good. You guys did real good. I'm proud of you. So here we go. The focus of this week was Journey Off the Map, Unknown to Him. No, unknown to, what does it go? Unknown to us, known to Him. What does that mean? It means that God's plan for each of our lives is so big, and that we can't handle it. So He has to give us just enough to take a step forward. For me, that's exciting. I like to live that way. Anybody else? How many of you guys like to know what's all ahead? And you have a hard time with those, especially if it's your spouse that just kind of lives on the cutting edge. I'm the cutting edge guy. My wife is the detail girl. I drive her crazy. But God Himself, I would say, is both. But He understands that we can't handle the plan He has for our life. So often, that's what it's like a journey off the map, because you can't really see what's ahead. And so let's look at the scripture that was the main scripture for the week, and it's Isaiah 30, 21. Isaiah 30, 21. And it says, whether you turn to the right or turn to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. You know, Ali is getting used to our nation, because in America, you got a lot of choices. You got a lot of paths you can follow. In many other nations, life is very simple, and you don't have a lot of options. We got options galore. And so it's hard to hear God's voice in the middle of it. It's hard to know, are we really on God's path, or are we kind of on our own, hoping that God is in it? So we want to make sure that we're on God's path. Now, God's path is what we call, what He calls in His word, a narrow path. Let's look at Matthew 7, 13 and 14. And it says, enter through the narrow gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to death, destruction. And many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. That means there's a lot of people that go to church, isn't there? Does everybody go to church go to heaven?
No.
It all depends on, are we on His path? He says that it's those who do His will that enter in. So the question we need to ask ourselves, are we in God's will? Do we know God's plan? do we even hear God's voice? Let's look at more on Isaiah chapter 30 to fully grasp this. Isaiah 30, 1 through 3, and then we're going to hit 18 to 21. And it says, what sorrow awaits my rebellious children? Now he's talking to Christians right now, not the world, because he's talking about his children. Says the Lord, you make plans that are contrary to mine. You make alliances not directed by my spirit, thus piling up your sins. Because sin is simply disobedience to God. It could also mean not choosing to go his perfect will. We might be doing good and still in sin. We might be going to church, still in sin. We might be a deacon, still in sin. Might be an elder, still in sin. Might even be a pastor and still in sin. Are we on his path or are we on our own? For without consulting me, you have gone down to Egypt, which represents the world, for help. You have put your trust in Pharaoh, which represents the devil, for protection. Because as long as we're not putting our trust in God, we're putting our trust in someone else. You have tried to hide in his shade, but by trusting Pharaoh, you will be humiliated, and by depending on him, you will be disgraced. So the result of us making our own plans is what? Humiliation and disgrace. How many of us have been there before? How many of us would like to remain there? No, it's not a fun place. We don't have to be in that place. God has a better place for us and a better plan for us. But will we listen? The biggest obstacle we have of hearing is there's only one reason we don't hear his voice. It was actually two different reasons, maybe three. And I've said it before many times because I think we always got to hear this. There's three main reasons we don't hear God's voice. Number one, unconfessed sin. Number two, unforgiveness. And number three, an unrenewed mind. As long as we have confessed our sins, have no unforgiveness in our heart, and are constantly renewing our mind, we can hear God's voice. There's no other reason we can. If we're having a hard time, that's the checklist we got to look at. And let's look at Isaiah 30, 18 through 21. It says, so the Lord must wait for you to come to him so he can show you his love and compassion. We're often waiting on God, blaming God, but God is just saying, why don't you just come to me? I will heal you. I will strengthen you. I will give you the power over sin. I will give you the strength to forgive. Just come to me as you are. Blessed are those who wait for his help. Do we wait or do we just step out without him? O people of Zion, O church, who live in Jerusalem, who live in New Jersey, you will weep no more. He will be gracious if you ask for help. He will surely respond to the sound of your cries. Though the Lord gave you adversity for food and suffering for drink, he will still be with you to teach you. See, being in Christ does not mean we won't suffer. You know what? We'll probably suffer more for being in Christ. Big difference from us and the world, as Amy saw, Amy went to South Africa excited for what God's going to do through her life, but had no clue that it meant just a bunch of pain and struggle and challenges. But what did she gain out of it? It had purpose. Now that she's back, she's thinking about it, praying about it. Oh yeah, God, you're making me a leader. I had to go through it. So whatever we go through now has purpose. Amen? Amen. You will see your teacher with your own eyes. Your own ears will hear him. Right behind you, a voice will say, this is the way you should go, whether to the right or to the left. For 20 years, I've had the most exciting life. 20 years next month of walking with the Lord, of hearing his voice, of going all over the world, but this is the thing I really want to encourage you, is often we think we have to become a missionary in order to live the exciting Christian life. We have to join YWAM, and YWAM was exciting. But I'm not no longer in missions. I live sometimes a pretty mundane life. Well, maybe not. But facing the same things, going through the same routine. Can life get exciting in the midst of the routine? God wants to be in everything, everywhere. You don't have to leave your job unless God says to join missions. You can make your job your mission, and you can simply say each day, Holy Spirit, here I am, use me. And in the midst of your routine, one of the greatest authors, one of the greatest books by Brother Lawrence, Practicing His Presence, he was a chef in a kitchen, and that's all basically he ever did. But he practiced dishwashing has one of the most powerful books on practicing his presence. It don't matter what your job is, don't matter where you're at is, if you put God in it, life will change and excitement will happen. And you'll have purpose and God will use you. And that is what life can truly be all about. But first, we got to get broken free. And we had a powerful song earlier, didn't we? About breaking free. I think God wants to make sure that none of us leave this place bound anymore. That all of us can leave this place free, our ears hearing, our eyes seeing, and God directing our path. So once again, I'm going to ask the youth to come up, and we're going to do that same song that they did earlier. Get ready. Amen.
There's an army rising up. when I first saw that, it moved me. Each one of us, let me start over. We heard throughout this service, each person got up and talked about hearing the voice of the Lord, walking it out. Each of us want to be in the army of God. God has his angel armies already set for the great and glorious day. And each of us have accepted the Lord. Each of us want to walk with the Lord. Each of us do hear the voice of the Lord. Each one of us are in that army. Are we willing to stand up and walk according to that voice that is calling us? That says, come, rise, break the chains on my people. Break the chains in my life. Break the chains in the world. Each one of us is that army. Each one of us has to make the choice to say, Lord, I am willing to go to my workplace. I am willing to die to myself. I am willing to look foolish. I am willing to lay hands on. I am willing to do what it takes. It's a choice. Each one of us are called. You heard the speakers. They all had to make that choice. They all had to die to themselves. Are we in the army of God? And are we willing to go out and break the chains? We all want to be those people, but let's be those people.
Man, are you fired up? Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah. That's the war cry. Amen. Hallelujah. So, we're ready to leave this place, the army of God. Your mission field is out there when you leave those doors. You've been equipped, you've been inspired. Now go out and serve. Now, if you're still in this place and you feel like there is something still holding you back, there's some kind of resistance in your life. Either you have not given your life to Jesus Christ, or you have, but there's deliverance, there's healing that's needed. Come forward. Do not leave this place with a chain still in your life. Amen? So I'm going to encourage you. We're going to open up this place for prayer. Again, Wednesday night, come out for the special service with this guest speaker. And then Thursday, let's go hit the streets and do some evangelism together as a body. Amen? 6:15, meet here. But right now, if you need prayer, come up here. God bless you.